Now, that's gonna introduce our next keynote speaker coming from Canada. And he's Mike Robbins. And Mike Robbins studied visual arts at York University, Toronto, Canada, and has picked up the technical side of his trade while working at Helios Design Labs for the past 13 years. He's responsible for staying on top of the latest and greatest digital technologies and other projects. Helios Design Labs is a Toronto-based multidisciplinary design studio. It designs experiences that combine the art of traditional storytelling with new and emerging technologies in web, mobile, and animation. Its work is diverse, ranging from campaigns from multinational corporations to experimental collaborations with artists and musicians. So I'm very happy and delighted that just directly from Canada, we have, during 3 days, Mike Robbins.
Thank you, Arnaud. Well, I was going to introduce myself, but Arnaud already did so. Actually, I was going to go into a little bit more depth and detail why I'm here speaking and what I'll sort of speak about. I think what I'd like to do is actually describe our work, as the interactive documentary from more a creator's standpoint rather than the user's experience standpoint. And I think I should preface this all by saying that actually I've been having this discussion with Arnaud as the organizer. He used the word expert, and I had issues with that. I come actually as a doer. I think I call myself a hewer of wood and carrier of water, and not an expert. I think what I can do here is just give you some of my thoughts. These are my thoughts and some of our experiences, and but speak to you as definitively a non-expert. And I think actually you should use that word or listen to that word with some degree of skepticism if anybody does portray themselves as an expert in the field of interactive documentary. You should regard them with a certain amount of suspicion, because actually that's one of the things I'd like to talk about today, is there is in this field, I believe, no experts. And I think that's due to the nature of the medium itself and where it's at in its life cycle, and how all the different projects that it contains are put together. I can start actually by talking a little bit about Helios and what we do, and in a really general way, how we do it. As the preface to me being on stage here, we've been around for quite a while, working as a small creative studio in Toronto. And in our past incarnations, we've worked as print designers, broadcast media designers, and to some degree, early forms of interactive work. And it's only been in the last 5 years that we've actually started working and concentrating mostly on interactive documentary production, which is why I'm here. And I think the reason why I mention this is that as a studio, we consider ourselves opportunistic. We work on a field, an endeavor, and when opportunities present themselves, we take them. So we've gone from being a print studio to a broadcast motion graphics studio, and through a relationship that we had with the National Film Board, certain people there have now started working as interactive documentary and I guess nonfiction interactive projects as well, as our sort of primary mover. And the National Film Board, about 5 years, 4.5 years ago, approached us through the agency of Kat Zizek, who we've talked about before. All roads seem to lead to Kat in this medium, and her producer, a very smart, intelligent fellow called Jerry Flahive, came to us with this project called High Rise. And I'll talk a bit more about High Rise as we go through, and I'd also like to present another project that we're currently working on. And they had an interesting proposition. It was going to be a 5-year project, and they didn't know what they were going to do. Except it was about high rises, and they had a general sense of methodology, scope, and the important thing was that they had no script. There was nothing planned apart from there was the period of time that they were going to be rolling out this project, and there was a general subject matter, a general sense of scope, and the fact that they wanted this initially to play out on the internet. And it was a fascinating thing for us, because we were used to people coming with storyboards, definite plans, budgets, a beginning and an end. And so we said, yeah, we're in. And so 5 years later, we're in what I call the age of wonder. And what I'm showing you here, this idea, I think the age of wonder, is a reference to a point in time in Europe's history, starting in the late 1700s and going to the early 1800s, where science began to emerge in Europe, and these societies, scientific societies, arose, and they explored things like, in this case, flying balloons. They looked at what gases were, what was electricity, gravity, all these things that we take for granted back then were these unimaginably fantastical things that made people wonder what they were. And I believe actually that our medium, that of interactive documentary, is in that phase of wonder. That we as creators and we as the audience wonder quite often what these expressions are. How are these expressions made? And I think also I'd like to posit that these expressions they're experimental. And that's the important thing to remember as well, is that we're in this age of wonder also involves, it's an age of experimentation. And it's an age of success. I show you this floating balloon, and there's other pictures of hot air balloons collapsing in flame, and people running away in horror. Humphrey Davy taking a dog and starving it of oxygen, and in front of a crowd of bewigged and perfumed Royal Society members. And all the time, they're wondering, what is this all about? And I think that's where my idea of there not being any experts in this field is, because I think it is still too new, and I think the rules, and this is the other important part, the rules are being made, but they're just not in place yet. So I think that in this sort of world of flux, there's an advantage. You can do what you want. There's a disadvantage in that, because you can do what you want, you can easily confuse people, or you can confuse yourself, and you end up with an experience that is, frankly, confusing. And as I struggle to unconfuse myself, I think I'd like to move on to how it actually really works for us at Helios. And I'm a I'm sort of offering this as like a case study of not of particular projects, but of methodology. And our work, we work with filmmakers quite a lot, and filmmakers, and we are here. I've given you a sort of triad of what could go into a project. So we have a filmmaker, and then you have the programmer, and the technologist, and then you have the guy with the cool glasses, not me, the designer. And I think what we've seen throughout the years that we've been working on this is there's a sense of perceived barriers between each one of these buckets, as it were. And where we've tried to work, and I'll back this up a bit, I think what we've also learned from these last couple of years of working in this field is that actually it is about learning. It's because it is the age of wonder, that there are no rules. You do things, you listen to people, you try things, you learn from them. So what we've learned is that I think the entire sort of workflow experience, these models of collaboration, are almost as much about learning as they are about what you show people. And it was interesting seeing Remco talk about his experience with Unspeak. You finish a project, and then you realize after you've finished that there are parts that are broken, that do not work. They are like this balloon that I was showing you crashing in flames. You build a new one. And I think that's a really important part. And that's a really, I think, key intrinsic part of the medium, is that you can easily learn from your mistakes, or the things that you thought you could do better, and go on and do something else based on that, and hopefully make it better. But I think at the same time, you have to realize as well, is that the audience, very patient, is still looking at the art form and wondering, I'm not quite getting it. And I think that's also the reason why I think conferences like this exist. We have people like me who should actually never be speaking in front of people like you, but I have to, because I think we're still in the phase where things have to be explained. This is like modern art in the beginning of the 1900s, where it's a new form of expression that has to be explained. And I mean, we just can't throw out our projects as product and say, there you go. If you don't get it, then bully for you. It's important, I think, that these are explained. And there will come a time where we don't have to explain them. I think that the medium will have developed its language, its ways of communication. There will be rules. And this kind of loops into, it's a fellow Canadian, a crusty old guy who's been long dead, Marshall McLuhan, once wrote about a medium was a medium, a new medium, when it was broken. When it's broken, it's actually in a form of flux. It's a form. It's vital. It is a vital. It's an age of wonder. And then was his theory is that when a medium, actually by dint of its practitioners hammering away at its language, its rules, its idiom, its structure, at some point you will achieve its success, and that medium becomes at that point art, and no longer the vital. It's still vital. But it's no longer this changing, emerging, coalescent amalgam of success and failure. So, getting back to our idea of perceived barriers, this is something that we've learned over the past, is that when we will work with filmmakers, like we've a project we're still working on, a project called Offshore, about offshore, the impact of offshore drilling and its impact on people, places in harm's way. We worked with a filmmaker called Brenda Longfellow, and she comes from a very classic, traditional, beautiful, linear, big film documentary sensibility. But she came to us with this idea that she wanted to make a documentary in a non-linear fashion, to make it so that it used the tools that she, quite frankly, admitted, and still admits, she doesn't fully understand. And to her, this was like this, you know, this mysterious and dangerous pool that she was just about to dive into. And like basically her maxim or her ask of me and the rest of the guys at Helios is, I have this idea, I want you guys to fuck it up. And so we said, yeah, we're good at fucking shit up. So that's what we did. But what was interesting too is that there's this transfer of interests. She's looking to us for non-linearity. She's looking at us for chaos, for immersion, for interactivity. But what we were in turn looking for her, and we found this out throughout the course of the relationship that we have, is we were looking her language that she brought, her cinematic language that she brought to our world, and our world being the trust me, I'm a programmer, or funky glasses, the design world. What we found was that her cinematic language was something that we found attractive as much as she found our language of code and design attractive. So what happens is, I think, cross-pollination, and those barriers actually start to disappear. I'm just going to grab a quick drink of water. So with this breaking down of barriers comes a new thought, and then sort of a new addition to the way we perceive our role in this, in working in this medium. And what we've developed, and it's good for me actually to go to conferences like this and to see other people speak and to say what they're doing and exposing themselves, well, their work, hopefully, to we'll talk about their work. And I think there is a common sensibility that begins to emerge, and maybe perhaps this is one of these new emerging rules, is the idea of design by code. And where we use code, like computer code, as another tool, similar to Photoshop or After Effects or Illustrator, any of these sort of classic design tools, we're looking to not replace, but to augment with the use of code. And it's the same thing with design. And so in some respects, we start to say, well, actually, we're storytelling by design. And or as much as the filmmaker comes to us and saying, can we use design to tell a story? Becomes this cross-pollination, which comes to the idea of applied indivisibility. So at our company, my company, small company, we have, it's 9 people. We're too small to actually have titles. So the idea of one of us calling ourselves a creative director or a chief financial officer or chief technology officer is ridiculous. But we do actually have roles that we do tell the rest of the world this is what we do. My title would be which I hate is that of creative technologist. That was given to me by a producer that we have, and she said, "Mike, you have to call yourself something." And I said, "Isn't Mike good enough?" And she would say, "No, you are now creative technologist. And I asked Sarah, what does this mean? And she says, I don't know. But then I thought, well, wait a minute. This is all part of, now I've made my bed. I have to lie in it. You know, this is the idea, this medium that we work in that has no rules. Well, now, actually, I have a job title that I have no idea what it means. So, actually, I've spent the last year and a half, 2 years now, kind of working through in my own funny way, my own meaning for the job. And I think I bring up an aphorism, and I kind of hate aphorisms, but they are a way of describing things, applied indivisibility. And I think my job is to make sure that there is no barrier between code, a person who codes, a person who wears cool glasses and designs, and it's not me, and the storyteller, and that there is this indivisibility to the whole process. So there shouldn't be actually any fear of I'm a storyteller. I have a story to tell, a project, something that I want to get said and expressed in this medium. There shouldn't be any fear in that person coming to a studio like ours, or being able to do it themselves, or somehow by any means possible getting their story made. And I think that by any means possible is another super important term and way to think. And that there should not be any fear or apprehension of, oh, computer code, you know, oh, that's for technical people. And then on the designer's point, saying, well, I'll let you storyteller tell the story, and I'll add my bibbidi bobbidi boo stuff to it. It doesn't work that way. I mean, I think what we've learned is that the creative process that goes on through the course of a project is a lot like living in a small room with a bunch of people. You get to know them very well, for better or for worse, and you become sort of very acquainted with the idiosyncrasies of the human nature. And there's argument, there's agreement, there's tears, laughter. It's like a little mini opera that happens all in the course of a small room. But I think the important thing is to be able to put yourself in that position so that it can happen. And I'm saying this on the point of view of the creator. To the audience, to the viewers, it means nothing. They see something. But as I say that, the next thing that we've learned as well, and getting, I think this is still part of the age of wonder, and I think this is still the big part, the hurdle, I think, of the medium that we're working in that we haven't overcome or fully grasped or fully conquered. It's the Everest, I think, of expression, is the idea that how you say something is as important as what you say. And I think we'll bring up the ubiquitous Kat Cizik again. She said something I thought that was really super important, and this kind of defined, I think, her work, and I think it's defined a lot of other of our peers' work, and I know it's defined or helped us. There's our work. And there's two things that she said, and this is sort of the fickle nature of creators. They can do this. They can say one thing, and then 1 year later say completely the opposite. The first thing she said, that the internet is a documentary. And by that, she was saying that just by sitting in front of your computers, going through whatever social media platforms that you're going, Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, YouTube, your email, news channels, Netflix, basically anything that you sit in front of a computer or through your smartphone or through your tablet comes to you in sort of like this whole sort of on a large meta level is a documentary. And then just as starting to grasp that idea, she can come out and say, the documentary is the internet. And it's like, wait a minute, I just understood that part. Now you're telling me this. But then this also boils down to the point that I was trying to make earlier, that there are no rules. I'm talking a long time here. what's that? 1 minute. Okay, this is going to cut, what's that? 2 minutes. Okay, I better start rocking here. I didn't realize I was babbling so much. Hang on a second. So, the idea, we have a new kind of model. I think we can all grasp that. What I'm showing here is something that I think is fragile. It's homemade. It's made out of rubber bands and tissue paper, but it still works. It still flies, and it still actually excites people's imagination. And I think that's an important part to realize as well, to keep people going. And we go to High Rise, where I was going to actually explain a little bit more about the value of open source. But I think also what's really important is the idea of open planning, is to actually have no plans. I think that that's really important. When people actually come and say, I'm going to make an interactive experience that also unfolds in a book, and it's going to be a mobile, it's going to be a video game. You can't have those plans, I think, in advance. Those plans have to come to you as needed, opportunistic. And then, now, this is one really quick, I'll go through this really quickly, a collaborative model that we worked with in conjunction with a filmmaker in Tuscaloosa, Alabama. His town, his city was devastated 3 years ago by a tornado that destroyed about a quarter of it. And his documentary takes the form of a spoken word. It's a letter to the future disaster survivors. Now, what was interesting in this collaborative process was the fact we've never met him. It's a very intimate, intricate project that we've worked on. We've never met the guy. And we talked by Skype. But somehow we were actually able to share the screenwriting or the script writing process online collaboratively. And the other thing that was really important about this project is an idea we're just grasping ourselves. It's the idea of just-in-time filmmaking spelled out. But the important thing here is that when he came, when we started working together on this project, there was nothing. And there was no script, there was no film. There was basically an idea, so that through our Skype conferences, our collaboration through Google Docs, and through us working iteratively with him, he did this thing where he's saying, Andy, we need this scene here. And he said, yeah, I'll film that, I'll have that for you for tomorrow. And I don't have time, unfortunately, but it's on the internet. I mean, that's the other thing too. All this stuff is on the internet, so you don't really need me to go through screenshots of work that we've done. I just have to explain why the hell we're doing this. But the important thing, I think, with Andy's work, and I think this is like a really interesting idea, and something going forward, is people coming to us with, we're starting with nothing, and being able to actually collaboratively build something. I mean, it happens so often that you convert one form of media to another. That's what a lot of the interactive documentaries are, or can be, that I've got this idea, I've got this body of film, make this interactive. But our idea, collaborative model, is to start from ground zero, scratch, and to build something together. And, am I done?
Okay, thank you very much. Very inspiring about your theories and about your philosophy. I really like it. We have time for a couple of questions, but we will have Mike with us till Sunday because he will be part of our Popathon that will start today, more or less in the evening. So he will be with Simon Duflo, an overall mentor of the Popathon. So we can use his enormous, he's very humble, but his enormous knowledge in this field, using creating prototypes with 5, 6, or 7 teams that we are having here. So time for quick questions, like really summarized questions. We have one there and two there. That's okay, Philo, please? Just quick. because we don't have enough time.
You mentioned, and we heard this earlier as well, that testing is really important. How do you do your testing? Could you share a bit of that?
Well, I think actually the most, I think the idea of user testing to me is a no-brainer. Test from the beginning. What we also do is we try never to actually storyboard in a conventional manner work. It's done as an interactive prototype from day one. So we're constantly sharing that between ourselves with the collaborators that we're working with and whoever else we think that can understand the project at that point in time. But having said that, I also think too, and this, what Remco is saying earlier, totally resonating, is that the true user test is, unfortunately, when you release it into the wild. Did that make sense? Okay.
Okay, one more. Well, I hear one quick question. Yes? So Mats Dambo from Denmark, Copenhagen.
Hi.
Mess.
The applied indivisibility and your role as a so-called creative technologist makes me wonder, is this a necessity to be able to create creative interactive documentaries, that there's one person who can code and actually understand the story and the creative vision?
I think actually what there needs to be is some form of communication. If it could be one person or if it could be everybody's on the same page, our experience is that a filmmaker doesn't have the knowledge or the time or the patience to fully get down to the technical possibilities and ramifications. And you do need, and somebody who's a programmer doesn't really actually have the time, inclination, or sensibility to get inside of the filmmaker. So I think it is a simple reality that you do need an arbitrator, a facilitator, a mixer-upper of, a fucker-upper of things.
Okay, Mike will be all the day with us until the night, and the day of tomorrow you can just go here if you are interested in the Pop-a-thon, or you can just meet up with him, whatever, he's very accessible. So he's not out of the conference till Sunday. We don't have more time. I'm so sorry for other questions that have arisen here, but we are very have a very tight schedule today. So we have to quit here. So I'm asking for a big round of applause for Mike.